dobrodošli. Samo da upravimo formalnosti. Pred nami je pogovor z Ianom Brennanom. Vse o njem boste izvedeli v predstavitvi, ki jo bo imel v pogovoru z njim Chris Aikman. Pogovor bo potekal v angleščini, so I will switch to English now. But if anybody needs translation to Slovin, če kdo potrebuje prevod v slovenščino, mu ga tudi preskrbimo. Če ne, we will continue in English only.
Yep. This is Ian Brennan. I'm Chris Aikman, Dober Dan. We actually have been working together on one project over the last year and another one coming up with Glitterbeat, but we never actually met till today, so only on Skype, so it's nice to welcome you to Ljubljana and meet you in person. Ian is a Grammy-winning record producer. He's an author. He works in conflict resolution. He does many, many things. He's produced 4 Grammy-nominated records, 2 in the world music category, 2 in the traditional folk category. He's also the author of 4 books. In the studio, he has worked with Tenai Irwin, Lucinda Williams, David Hidalgo from Los Lobos, Corinne Tucker from the great Portland band Slater Kinney, Bill Frisell, the Dirty Dozen Brass Band, Richard Thompson, and many, many more. In the last years, his recording adventures have taken him increasingly far afield into countries and regions with recent histories of conflict like Rwanda or South Sudan. He somewhat recently produced the Zomba Prison Project album, something we'll talk about quite in depth later. The album is called I Have No Everything Here with prisoners of the Zomba Maximum Security Prison in Malawi. And he was nominated for the Grammy and World Music for that album just this last year. In the past couple of years, he's also produced, as I mentioned, and recorded 2 albums of Southeast Asian music. One is Hanoi Masters, War is a Wound, Peace is a Scar, which included musicians who were veterans and survivors of the American Vietnam War. And then also an album from Cambodia that Glitterbeat will release in August, called Khmer Rouge Survivors, They Will Kill You If You Cry. And this is a recordings of traditional-based musicians from Cambodia that were survivors of the genocidal Khmer Rouge regime. For all these projects, he's also usually accompanied by his wife, Marielena, whose images, both still and moving, are quite central to the presentation of what Ian is doing. His 4th and latest book, How Music Dies or Lives, Field Recording and the Battle for Democracy in the Arts, was published in February of this year. It is a feisty, opinionated, but beautifully human book that deals in depth with the role of music in our cultures, our lives, and our souls. The book looks at the value and function of music from an abundance of angles and prisms, and even I think a 3-hour discussion here of its contents would not do justice to it. So I highly recommend that you read it. Ian has said that, quote, music and other forms of art are by far the most effective kind of social work that exists. A single nameless one-hit wonder brings more comfort to the world than almost any single psychologist can hope to in a lifetime. This sense of mission and belief in the transformative personal and social value of music is something that penetrates and informs all his work. So, welcome.
Thank you.
Before we begin, is it okay if we sit up there? Is that all right? I mean, I know you have to come back and forth. Is that gonna mess you up too much? How much are you gonna use that computer?
Very little.
Okay, can we sit here? Is that all right? I just don't like division. That's one of the big things.
Yeah.
Right, so we're gonna come to you. I also believe in coming to people.
I don't think we need the mic.
Is that all right? Is it going to mess anybody up? Okay. All right. Oh, they messed you up. I wanted to mess you up, dude. That was the old goal. All right, so.
Much better.
All right.
Seems a lot less abstract.
Yes. We're not here to have a scholarly scholarly talk.
So we're going to do this in two parts. First, we'll talk a bit about the book.
Yep.
And the second part, we'll look at actually the music, look and listen
okay.
to the music that you've been involved with. And we'll use two case studies for that, the Zomba Prison Project album and also the upcoming Khmer Rouge Survivors.
Okay, great. Awesome.
So the book, I mean, it's really, you know, the title is provocative right out of the gate, but I really didn't know, you know, knowing a lot of the projects you had done, I didn't really know, have a sense of like what the book might be about. And as it turns out, the book's about almost everything.
Yeah, too much.
Yes. No, I don't think so. I think it's really interesting. I mean, what brought you to write it? I mean, what was the...
You know, I never wanted to write a book on music, but basically Marlena was sick of me talking about it to her all the time, so I said write about it, so I did. So it's because of her. I think she was just tired of hearing me rant on, so she figured I should rant on to other people.
Yeah, in a way that sort of describes the format of the book also, because it's mostly vignettes.
That's okay. There you go.
We tried to go punk rock here, but it didn't.
Yeah, the whole book is about how the cart should not be before the horse. So we are the horse, that's the cart. Sorry.
Yes, I find, I will read some quotes from it in a minute, but I find the subtitle of the book very intriguing. The subtitle is Field Recording and the Battle for Democracy and the Arts. And you write at one point, all recordings are ultimately field recordings. They document life or lack thereof and arise from a specific time and place. If that place is artificial, then the results usually will be as well. Ultimately, any technology only exists as a means to convey feeling and has little to no value otherwise in and of itself. So many of the projects you've done in the last years have been recorded on quite simple means, I would imagine. I mean, do you use like multiple microphones when you're doing it? I mean,
I always use multiple microphones, and I want it to sound as good as it can possibly sound, but that's secondary. I mean, most people, if you look at their record collection, I mean, that's an old-fashioned concept, but if you look at the records that they have, sitting side by side are sonically diverse records. That's not what matters to people. What matters to people is that the record makes them feel something, and if it makes them feel something, that's a timeless record, and I think that should be the goal. What happens now is art by committee. What happens is things are literally compressed. They're literally compressed on a technological level, and so everything is just the same. And so basically you have now many of the same producers producing 110-track records that don't sound like 110-track records, that sound like they were made by a fucking child. And then they plug in some female singer in place, but then they fuck with their voice so much that you can't tell one from the other. And that's pop music today, in a nutshell. So there's very specific reasons why we've reached a bit of a crisis. And pop music always goes through crisis. But what it means is we're on the verge of something. But unfortunately, it will probably not happen because of the centralization of media. That's the difference. The centralization of media has such a stranglehold on distribution, right? So the big lie is that the internet is democratic. It's a naturally occurring force. It's going to fix everything. Bullshit, right? The internet is one of the worst things that ever happened in terms of centralization. And this is only the first generation. So who the fuck cares about Mark Zuckerberg? That's not who we're concerned about. We're concerned about who's going to take over those companies when he's gone. That's what we're concerned about. Not what this autistic nerd guy is like now, today, but when the corporations really get a hold of that shit, what's going to happen? It's already bad as it is. That's part of the rant. Sorry.
You say at one point in the book, something that really plays into that, you say we suffer from an overpopulation of sound. We suffer from an overpopulation of sound, but a dearth or lack of diversity.
Yeah.
How does this situation get created?
Well, basically, this is the big lie, this is the thing, is that we have more opportunity than ever to listen to more diversity and more voices, but people listen to fewer voices than ever before. That's the concern. So what happens with the superstar system is that in order to make tons of money. They want to make money out of copying by divorcing the artist from the labor. Once they divorce the artist from the labor, then it makes it very easy for them to make money without having to have the artist involved. So what's the easiest thing for them to do? To sell you one thing. Not to sell you 1,000 soda pops, but to sell you one soda pop, because it's one penny cheaper to produce that. So what happens then is that you've got these individuals that are superstars now. And in order to have a superstar system, you have to have people to believe and buy into the idea that they are not musical. We've got 7 billion people on the planet Earth, but there's a few folks that are so musical, you should spend $500 to sit in a soccer stadium on the top row with your video camera, looking at a video screen, not them, that you can't even see if it's really them. And that's as musical of an experience as you're ever going to have in your lifetime. That's a superstar system. And what it is it's milked. The reality is that almost every person on the planet Earth has one good song in them. Almost everybody on the planet Earth only has one good song in them, though. Right? So that means make that song, then go away. Right? Don't keep making records. And why has Neil Young, why has Bruce Springsteen, why have they made more records than most nations in the world combined have ever had distributed internationally? There's something wrong with that. Nothing against Neil Young and Bruce Springsteen, but they're not that good, right? They're not better than the entire country of Slovenia. They are not better than all of Africa. Sorry, right? They might be good, but they're not that good, right? That's the superstar system. Not that I'm opinionated, sorry.
Yeah, I imagine the same is true in Southeast Asia, but I've noticed like when you go to Africa, there are probably less productions happening domestically than before. You know, in the 70s, 80s, when there was actually some sort of economy of music,
yep.
there were more things happening. There was actually, you know, we think that there's more music, but there's, you know, the economics of it more and more, I think, shuts music down. You mentioned records because you talk about records a lot in this book.
Yeah.
And you talk about records in really two ways, in almost a bit of a dichotomy. On one hand, you know, they're an important voice for people. They are an important part of our culture. But on the other hand, you indicate at times that you find them inauthentic.
Right.
Can you comment on that?
Well, I mean, I think the issue is that repetition of sound is, it's always a double-edged sword. There's good and there's bad. The main concern neurologically is to listen to the same things over and over and over and over and over again. It's not necessarily good for you. And the example of that is that historically, in most cultures, an encore in a performance was a demand to do the exact same song again, differently and better. That's what an encore was. Right? So great singers were expected to stand up there and do a song 10 times in a row, and if the audience wanted it, they had to do it again, but differently and even better than they'd already done it. That's what an encore was. An encore was not, okay, it's 91 minutes in our 90-minute contracted set, let's go backstage and smoke some more pot and then come out and do that fucking song we hate that made all the money that paid for our swimming pool house and come out and do that, because if we don't, there's going to be a riot. That's not what an encore is supposed to be. So there's this repetition, and what that means is that a lot of people have a closer relationship with Sweet Home Alabama by Lynyrd Skynyrd than they do their wife, right? They listen to that more closely than they do their family members. That's the reality, right? They spend more time with television, with Anderson Cooper, than they do with their children. So there's obviously something not entirely healthy about that. It's not right or wrong, right? But repetition is bad for us. Neurologically, we are novelty craving beings. That's what our brain seeks, and without it, our brain dies. Not that I'm opinionated at all.
I mean, you also talk about that in the book, about repetition in terms of actual, the composition and structure of modern music,
yeah.
That it's based on loops and
yeah.
Things like that.
Yeah.
Do you think that there is something that you could, you know, when you get into recording, there's always, we talked about this a bit when we were having coffee, there's always this question of, are you ever making something authentic?
Right.
Do you think it is possible to make, you know, when you're mediating with a microphone, is it possible to have authentic expression?
Yeah, absolutely. If the microphone disappears, right? If the microphone is not why you're there. That's why I like to record outdoors. That's why I like to record in places people are unfamiliar with and uncomfortable in or comfortable in, not in studios, because you will have an authentic experience, and that's what should be documented. And, you know, multi-track recording is amazing. Sampling is amazing. These things are not bad. Nothing's bad. It's never as simple as that. But when we look at recording and we say, do people really think that they're going to make a better album on any level than Frank Sinatra during the Capitol era? Do they really think that they're going to make a better recording than Sam Phillips made in Sun Studios, right, when they are recording direct to a master? They're not. I mean, it's almost impossible to do so. And so what those records had, of course, was they had authenticity that you were recording something that actually happened. So fast forward to multi-track recording. Fast forward even further to people shuttling files back and forth across the ocean to somebody maybe they've never even seen before or never met. Nothing wrong with this. It's beautiful on a certain level. But on another level, what happens is what you're listening to is something that never happened. Most of the things that you're listening to never occurred, right? They are a manipulation at their inception. It was a 2-year process to make a 3-minute pop song that doesn't sound any different than probably every other song that person's done before, because they had one good song in them and they already did it, so they just keep trying to redo it and they never get there. So they spend 2 years doing this 3-minute pop song with a bunch of people and having this thing occur that never occurred, and then they go back and back engineer it and try to go out on the road and recreate this thing live that never even happened in the first place. That's the danger. One of them.
I wasn't like this at coffee, was I?
You were. You were very laid back at the coffee.
It's that fucking Slovenian coffee. Damn it.
I knew we shouldn't have got the second one. Maybe that was it.
This is one. It was two.
Okay, so in the last years,
Do you want the mellow version? Do you want the mellow version?
No.
It's all right?
I think it's real.
Sure? Yeah. You definite?
Yeah.
It's being filmed, that's the bad thing.
We're going to play some video. That'll calm it down for a minute. I mentioned this, and I think it ties into what you were saying about Springsteen, Michael Jackson, and so on.
Yeah.
Why Vietnam? Why Cambodia? Why South Sudan? Why are you going to these places to record? I'm sure there's more than one central motivation, but what is it as a counterbalance to this monopolistic, you know, single-minded culture that we seem to all be forced to experience? Is that one of the main motivations?
I mean, that's completely the motivation, is to go to underrepresented regions. And most people end up landlocked within their own borders. And even today at the hotel, I walked down some alley and there's an old-fashioned record store that I think you have to call to get access to. It looked like there was a little sign with a number. And in the window, they had about like a display of probably 24 Slovenian singles by women in Slovenia over the years. I think mostly in the 60s, it looked like. And that's landlocked within the borders, you know. And that's great. It's wonderful. There's nothing wrong with that. The problem is the imperialism with the English language. And it's a perfectly naturally occurring force. Whoever invents the technology has first dibs to it. That's the way that works. It's normal. It's just not really been reflected on. And it permeates. And so when we were in Cambodia making the record that's about to come out, 19 out of 20 songs in the top 10, I happened to see it in the local paper, 19 out of 20 songs were English language songs. 19 out of 20. That's not necessarily healthy. When we were in Burundi in January making a record, we were sitting outside at a cafe, and overhead came Katy Perry on the overhead speakers. Nothing wrong with Katy Perry. I mean, there's a lot wrong, but nothing wrong with Katy Perry. That's fine. But the point is, what are the odds that you'll be sitting in Brooklyn and you'll hear a Burundian singer come on over the speakers? Impossible. Because there is no record from anybody in Burundi other than the drummers of Burundi that was put out in 1985 or whatever it is. So a Burundian singer, it's not even possible because the record doesn't even exist in the first place. So unfortunately, you can take a dart and throw it at a map and pretty much hit a country that's underrepresented on an international level. And the belief is that anywhere you go, you will find music if you are willing to listen. And I think the key is we have to listen to each other. We can't just talk at each other. We have to listen to each other. Extremism is
based on people being isolated and not listened to. Who are the most extreme people? They're not the people that are from the Middle East. They're the people that were in Europe and America and were not listened to and were ostracized, and they're mad as fuck, and they want to compensate, and they overcompensate for that by going back and acting out in this way. Listening to each other is huge. Most people, all they want is to be listened to. They don't want you to say anything back. They just want you to hear them. They just want to know that they've been heard. And so this is why I think it's so important. And the thing is that it has to stand on its own, though. The songs have to stand on their own. The singers have to stand on their own. So it's not that you should just go to any country and record anything and put it out. It's not as simple as that, right? Bad records are not going to help anybody. There's already too much bad music in the world, right? We don't need bad music from other countries as well as all the bad music we're already getting from Los Angeles and London and Paris and the countries that dominate. I didn't even answer the question.
I remember from the first time I went to Africa, I realized there's really terrible drummers in Africa.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, it's, it just fights against all of these cliches. Of course, there's terrible music from these places also.
Yeah.
But is there something, I mean, you mentioned a lot in this book about that there needs, I mean, the word hope does come in
right.
quite a bit. And what are the structural changes that could happen to make this possible to, let's say, have a more diverse representation of music? I mean, one thing you talk about in here, which I think is great, you talk about really specific things that individuals can do. And one is just, you know, go to festivals like this,
yeah.
actually make a conscious choice to listen to music in another language besides English, you know, things like that. I mean, do you think that in a way these kind of personal choices are the most profound ones?
Yeah, I mean, what's really important is that what gets put forth and leads to burnout always is the idea that you're going to totally solve something. So there's this idea, end World Hunger Day. What the fuck are you talking about, end World Hunger Day? You will never end world hunger. There will always be world hunger. Reduce World Hunger Day as much as we possibly can while still having hunger in the world should be the goal. Right? This is the concern we have. So it has to be realistic goals. We have to recognize that it is not something we can solve in a day, and really the big problems we will not solve in our lifetime. It's very egotistical to think we're going to solve it in our lifetime. And whatever progress we make, we know that probably it's going to be undone when we die, and it's going to get started all over again, right? That we're just a little speck here in all this, but we want to tip the scales in some way. So in America, one of the most radical acts that somebody could make is not to go to a protest rally, it's don't watch the Super Bowl. That's one of the most radical things somebody can do. Almost nobody does it. Almost everybody has been trained into that. They've been entrained into this idea that it's a national holiday and something that they have to do, right? That there's something wrong with you if you don't. Over half of the population watches that one thing. That's not healthy, right? It's not healthy to do that. So if you can turn away in some way, it's not going to change things dramatically, but it might make some small difference. I mean, that's the goal. More than anything else, it's just to be a little bit skeptical and kind of go, really? Are they that good? Right? Does the world really need another record by blank? Right? Do they really need another record when they haven't put out a good record since 1982? Right? You know, are they really going to get it this time? Right? Like all the writers are saying that this time they've really made the... how many times have I read a review that claims that this is the record where Bob Dylan is really back to form? Right? It's like, no, he's not. Right? He hasn't made a good record since Blood on the Tracks. Right? He's made a few okay records, and even that was a comeback record. So what the fuck is going on? Right? You know, I mean, Bob Dylan is amazing, but you know, just play live. Right? You know, that's great, and stop making records, right? You know, I mean, what Neil Young and Bruce Springsteen should do is say, well, you know, we went to the Canary Islands and we spent like $1 million over 2 years trying to make a good record, but I came to the realizations that I don't really write good songs anymore. They're not bad songs, but I've become a craftsman. So instead, I'm not going to put out a record this year. What I'm going to do instead is I'm going to tell you to buy this record from Molly. Right? So if every one of my fans would buy this record from Molly in lieu of buying my record, which is not very good and you're not going to listen to it very much, you're going to go back and listen to The River, which I'm on tour now recreating for you because it's so much better than what I've done in the last 35 years, that would be a good thing. Seriously, right? I really believe in anti-recording contracts. Pay the Rolling Stones to never make another record. Right? They should get paid every year to not make one. Right? Yeah. Seriously, right? you know, Neil Young, we don't need to hear, you know, we don't need to hear you do a cover record. We don't need to hear you experiment. Put that on free, you know, for free on the internet. Instead, get out there and promote something else. Say, listen to Khmer Rouge Survivors, right? Every
yes,
one of my
please,
fans, yeah, please, right? Every one of my fans, buy this record, right? Because instead of acting like a liberal because I've got this tattoo or this piercing or long hair or dress this way or have a really shitty attitude about life, right? I'm going to encourage you to buy this thing that might actually have some real impact. It might cause a company that's independent to employ two or three people, right? It might cause people to hear something they would not otherwise hear.
No, you never, that's going to be, I think, a habitual thing today. Just one more question there, then we're going to show some video and so on, then you can rant about that also. So.
No.
you talk a lot about traditional music in this book.
Yeah.
I mean, because a lot of the stuff that you've been recording in the last years is traditional music. Do we risk falling into a golden age theory when we talk about traditional musical cultures? Aren't all cultural processes and practices in ebbing and flowing between dying and being born again? Like Dylan said, actually, I think he said, those not busy being born are busy dying,
yeah.
For example. That was when he was making good records, by the way.
When was that?
Blood on the Tracks. I mean, wasn't it in fact healthy that punk rock killed some of the excesses of progressive rock like Yes and ELP? I mean, there is a sense that some things need to die and that move on, and I think even in traditional cultures that exists.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I think the thing that is of concern, there's two things, and the punk rock thing is a great example, is that nothing's good or bad. We have to be nuanced in our thinking. It needs to be more complex than that. What we have to be watchful for is that the system is so powerful, and it's not a conspiracy theory, it's so powerful, it's so assimilative, right, that it's not the impact that's important. What's important is what is sustainable or not sustainable. So with punk rock, what happened is that essentially it was great for a little while, and then over time what it did is it made everything amatorial, right, and devalued, at least before. Because what used to happen prior with stadium rock, I mean, I'm old enough to know, is that you would go, there'd be three bands, there'd be an unknown band, there'd be a band that got kind of known because they were the unknown band and they were kind of good, and then there'd be some headlining band. And every band, you know, it was founded on having at least one extraordinary element in the band. They had to, right? They had to have an extraordinary element to stand out. They had to have an amazing singer and or an amazing guitar player and or an amazing drummer. They had to have that at minimum, right? And so the danger with punk rock is it made it so that it didn't matter. The musicians didn't matter anymore, right? Because everybody could do it, right? So that's great. That was fine. But the model was meant to do it for your friends, not to get back up on the stage, divide people, and be over here, and have security guards in front like this, getting paid too much to kick your ass, right? And not have you enjoy the music. And so that's the assimilative aspect that's of concern. With traditional music, the thing we're concerned about is, yeah, that people want to draw these lines, that's fine, but they're basically trying to catch something that is constantly in flux. And it's so complex where things come from. And it doesn't really matter. I have no interest, really, in where things come from. I have an interest in where they're going. That's all I really care about. I don't care where it came from, because you can't prove it anyway. What I've learned over and over again, and this happened literally last week, I went back to Zomba prison. It's so strange with distribution, is that people will say, people in Africa are influenced by blues, or people in Africa are influenced by country, and then some BBC writer or somebody will go down and write some article about some phenomenon that may or may not be true, but probably is kind of exaggerated, about how rockabilly has an influence in Kenya and all this shit, which means probably two people have an influence, and you know, all that sort of thing. So the thing with country music in Africa is that the big person that I've run into over and over again, country music in Africa, is Don Williams, right? A lot of you probably have no idea who Don Williams is, right? So he was a big selling artist, right? But you know, he's kind of forgotten already. Great singer, amazing singer, but kind of forgotten already. So you know, you begin to doubt your experiences a little bit. But just last week we were there at Zomba prison, and this amazing songwriter, Thomas Binamo, was talking with him, and he was saying he likes country music, and I'm like, who? And he goes, Don Williams, right? And I go, Don Williams, like, what about Johnny Cash? No, right? The guy wears all black. The guy, you know, like trying to, you know, like cross the language barrier, trying to describe it. He's just like, no, right? You know, Merle Haggard, no, right? Didn't know any of that shit, right? But Don Williams, you know, somehow got through, right? So, I mean, that's where, you know, there is no purity, right? That's the big myth, the myth of purity. And that's a lot of what we're facing right now. And I think Italy is a really great example of this, right? Is that people talk about whether somebody's Italian or not. Are you fucking kidding me, right? This is one of the most assimilative, you know, diverse nations ever, right? They were multicultural before the term existed. If you went to Rome 2,000 years ago, I'm sure it was like the bar scene of Star Wars, right? You were, no, I'm certain, right? You were seeing people in tribes that don't even exist anymore, right? So there is no purity. Right? There is no purity. It's all going to be a basic combination of factors, and it's complex, and we should embrace the complexity. But emotionally, we want simplicity. It's normal. We understand. People are afraid. So the people that make us angry, just think about the fact that they're afraid. That's what's going on with them. They're afraid of complexity because complexity is hard because there's no certainty, and they want certainty. They want things to be definite. They want it to be all solved right now, and they want it to be within their own lifetime. And there is no certainty. It's all about the basic ambiguity that we have to live with and make peace with, and that fear that you're going to die. Everybody in this room is going to die, and you don't know when, right? And so people try to defend that by being in control. And with art, they're trying to control it through technology, right? And what they're trying to do is make themselves look better, right? Like taking a selfie and then redoing it 20 times. Fuck that. That's what you look like, right? You know, if you know, seriously, right? You know, and so, I mean, bands, when I record sometimes, they'll say, even the rare bands that pay me money and stuff, they'll say, well, we want to do other takes. I'm like, no, you're not, right? Well, maybe two, right? That's the way you sound, right? So if you want to do another take, let's stop. You go back and write more songs and practice for 6 months, and then we'll do another take, right? Because if we sit here and do this 12 times, the difference is just to you, right? Nobody is noticing that nose hair but you, right? Nobody cares about that. This is what you look like, right? And none of us really like the way we look. We don't like the way we sound. Too bad. Right? That's who you are, right? So you can't really change it. Not that I'm opinionated.
Okay, we're going to play some video from Zomba Prison Project.
Actually, I'm going to go to the back. Okay.
This is the album cover from Zomba Prison Project.
I beat the people, I beat them no more. I kill the people, I kill them no more. He took the great away when I was born again. Ni nari wanyenga, ni atoba ine.
Yeah, some amazing images and sounds. What was the genesis of you starting that project? I mean, when you went there the first time, were you in Malawi looking for other musics and then you heard about this, or did you go specifically there?
We were in Malawi. We met and discovered the Malawi Mouse Boys in 2011, and I've been wanting to do a project in prisons for a long time, feeling that the most underrepresented people really in the world in any culture are prisoners usually, maligned, even censored, literally censored. So we don't like to go back necessarily to the same countries repetitively because there's so many that are underrepresented, but we decided to go there and we didn't know what we would find at all. We knew there was a band there, but we didn't really record the band. The band's not that good, they're okay, right? They're standardized, but they're not that good, and they've gotten all this attention. But they're not on the record hardly. What it is the people within that hierarchy that are on the margins. So the best song is by the backup bass player, youngest guy in the band, who said he wasn't a songwriter, who wrote a song at the last minute for the record. Over half of the record are the women who have no instruments, don't believe they're singers, don't believe they're songwriters, but wrote songs specifically for the project. And they still don't have instruments, right? So as a result of the Grammy nominations, you know what people did? They gave more instruments to the men. Right? So the men now have even more instruments and the women have nothing. So when we went back last month, we gave a drum and a guitar to the women, right? Because they have that drum, and I thought, okay, at least they have a drum. I found out that drum they have to share with the men. They don't even have the drum all the time, right? They have to share it with them. So good old-fashioned misogyny, I suppose, but you know, trying to bring people out from the margins, right? Even within the hierarchy itself, I think it's so important. And I think, you know, really that's reflected by sometimes the best song on a record is by the person who is not usually the lead singer, you know, like Happy on Exile on Main Street is one of the best songs on the record, right? You know, so, I mean, there's many examples. When Pete Townsend would sing in The Who, I mean, even though he's writing the song, sometimes it was some of the best stuff or, you know, whatever other examples you can come up with, there's a million. But I think, you know, it's a form of that maybe.
What impact did this Grammy nomination have on the musicians in the prison? Because there was lots of stories. I heard some on BBC, and yeah. There was the front page of the New York Times. I mean, it was really quite a lot of like international press and attention. I mean, it's kind of a fairy tale story, and so you know the media could easily grab onto it. But did it change things there? Or I mean, you said that the women still don't have instruments. Are there other were the prisoners really aware of what was going on internationally?
Well, they didn't know what a Grammy was, almost any of them, if any of them, but they understood the significance of it. It gave them a lot of confidence. It was a big thing for Malawi. They've never had a nomination in the history of the country for anyone, which is true of most countries in the world. Ghana last year also had its first Grammy nomination for reggae. And, you know, so there's still many countries that haven't even ever received a single nomination. So it was a big deal for people. But then concretely what's happened is a lot of attention. It's a good story. No money, right? No money for anybody. So the journalists go there. They make money, right, off the story. I'm over tens of thousands of dollars in debt from this record, right? I mean, you know, it's a labor of love. And unfortunately, notoriously, we've talked about this before. We talked about this before we ever even put out the first record, is that human interest stories do not sell records, right? So it's awesome to be on television, or it's awesome to have some article written up, you know, nicely with lots of pictures. But, you know, on average, you know, your 67-year-old Sunday paper reading person is not going to be running out and buying a rock record or a roots record. They're just going to remember, yeah, there was this story about some people in Vietnam and, you know, or yeah, there was some prison somewhere in, I think, Africa maybe, and it was cool, you know, and that's nice, you know, it's a story, you share it with people, that's good, but in the end, you know, it hasn't really concretely changed a whole lot. The nice thing is that a lot of the folks that were involved have been released. And it's not necessarily as a result of this, but many of them are released. Very few of them are still there, which brings up the irony of people going there, right, generalizing, not being sophisticated or complex or really reflective at all. So they go there to see the band who got nominated for a Grammy, but the band did not get nominated for a Grammy. They don't visit the women, and then they hang out with a bunch of people who had nothing to do with the record, right? So there's this guy from Italy who went there, and he sent me this cell phone picture. They gave him access to the prison. He's surrounded by like five people, and he goes, I visited the band, right? They got the Grammy nomination. It's such a cool thing. And I looked at the picture. Not one person around him had anything to do with the record, right? I'm like, well, you went and recorded and filmed a bunch of people that have nothing to do with the Grammy nomination, right? You know, so I'm glad you had a good time, but you know, if you're really a documentary journalistic filmmaker, you might want to ask a few more questions, right? You know, and not make so many assumptions. Maybe.
I'm going to just show another video now from the Khmer Rouge survivors.
Yep.
This is the record that's out in August. That's the cover. These are some of the musicians.
ไปไกลบ่บ่พระพุทธพระธรรมพระ
Yeah, we need to wrap up, but I think it's, you know, these musicians in particular, it's so poignant because much like what happened in northern Mali during the Islamist insurrection, where music was banned, it was also true with the Khmer Rouge, right? I mean, most musicians were. How were you able to assemble these musicians?
Well, I mean, we were lucky. The gentleman that you see that was playing in the back of the minivan is Kong Nai, and he's a big star in Cambodia. And he's also had the good fortune of you know, getting the support of Peter Gabriel and having some opportunities to come to New York. He's retired now, so we were lucky enough to get him to agree to record with us, and we went all the way to the south of the country just to do that. But as you see, almost every single person in this particular project, Vietnam, it's veterans and people affected by the war, but almost all these people were literally physically affected, the ones that survived. And one of the most amazing songs on the record is again by a guy who's not a songwriter, not a singer. His name is Thuch Savange, and a landmine killed his mother and basically tore off his face when he was a small child. And his song is incredible. The lyrics are incredible. The vote, it doesn't sound like anything else, right? I mean, you know, there's no parallel you can draw to some other form of music. That's where ethnomusicology fails. It's so personal. And Soon Son, the man you see at the end, was injured also by a landmine, walks with the limp. And he's also a long neck guitar player, the Chappie Dung. I can't even think of the full name, but he's not famous the way that the Kong Nai is, but he's amazing, right? I don't want to compare artists, but I mean, he's you know, it's that amazing thing. He's probably as good, if not better, right? You know, he's just not as known. The last song on the record is, I think, 12-something minutes long, and it's him playing just in this trance, this blues trance, not American blues trance, but this blues trance, and he would not have stopped if his wife had not stopped him. You know, the incredible thing was, like, I was like, yeah, we're kind of on a schedule, and you know, but to this day, I regret it, because I'm like, I wonder how long that song would have gone on, right? I mean, I think... I don't know. I mean, it could have been hours, right? And it's amazing, right? I mean, I don't think you really, with trance music, I think you don't want it to stop. It shouldn't really stop. So, yeah, I mean, thank you for putting the record out. Thank you for doing that.
It's really our pleasure. Well, thanks to Druga godba for putting this on and bringing Ian. And it's been a really pleasure to talk with you and meet you. And thank you all for coming. It's been
I've got books up here that I brought here. They're 20 euros. The other book's 15 euros. The CDs are 10 euros. I don't want to take any of them home. Right? You know, I dragged them for like 30 minutes to get to the van and arrive here. I don't want to bring them home. Right? So please buy some. That would be awesome. Right? And I'm not like I am here up there. I'll laugh there.